You are listening to the Savvy Painter podcast, and I want to tell you that this weekend was super exciting because this weekend, the Savvy Painter podcast passed 2 million downloads. I was a little disappointed that I didn't get to watch it happen. It's kind of like watching the odometer flip on your car, but I am so happy that we have passed 2 million downloads. That's a huge, huge milestone. And it makes me really excited that so many people are able to enjoy the podcast. Speaking of which, I have some other exciting news. The Savvy Painter podcast is now available on Pandora. Pandora has a lot of exciting things happening in their development, and one of which is getting into podcasting. So it was a huge, huge honor to be invited to be part of their beta program. Bit by bit, they are launching the podcasting channel, and Savvy Painter is now part of that. So in addition to all the other places that you can listen to the Savvy Painter podcast, you can now hear it on Pandora. My guest this week is the artist Lisa Kairos. Lisa paints abstracted landscapes using encaustic paints and some collage. As she describes it, she chooses sites that hold the tension between the natural and human elements of landscape. In this episode, Lisa and I talk about the two times in her life when she had to renegotiate her idea of being an artist. The first was just after college, as she was deciding whether or not to go to grad school. And the second happened when she had her first child. We're all well-versed, I think, in the fears of becoming a parent and what that might do to an art career. So in our conversation, we decided to explore the benefits of being an artist and a parent. Lisa and I also talk about how a series evolves from a seed, then an idea, and finally morphs its way into a full body of work. And Lisa shares how she developed the Periphery Project, in which she explores the 400 miles of trails around the San Francisco Bay and gives us a glimpse into her process and how she creates her encaustic pieces. Here is Lisa Kairos. Lisa, welcome to the Savvy Painter podcast. I'm excited to speak with you today.
Hey, Andres. It's great to be talking with you too.
Tell me a little bit about when you started out as an artist. Was there sort of a moment or a decision that you consciously made to take this as your professional life?
Yeah, I think when I was in school, I wasn't sure. I thought when I got out of college, I went to university and got a degree in art, and I was pretty sure that was my path. But I knew from things that professors had told me while I was in school that it was a very hard, it was a very difficult thing to do once you're out of school with a lack of structure. And so I knew that the first couple of years out of school were going to be pivotal. So just getting out and really those first couple of years, finding space, finding time to work were very instructive for me. I think I learned a lot in those first couple of years. And there was a period of time where I lived by myself. I was in a live work space in Oakland, California. And I wasn't sure if I could make it. And somewhere in there, I figured it out.
Did that intimidate you or kind of throw you off when your professor said that?
Oh, absolutely. And it wasn't just one person. It was a message that I think a lot of us received along the way, that it's hard to make a go at it. And a lot of people don't continue. And I could see that too with the people I went to school with. A lot of people a couple years later weren't painting, weren't making art. So I think there's a big attrition rate there.
After college, during those years where you were trying to figure things out, what were some of the things that you discovered that helped you keep your practice and remain as an artist?
I think making the time and space for an art practice, even though I was needing to work a day job, was really important. It was really important that I believe that I wanted it badly enough to make the time for it, even after I would come home from work and be really tired and maybe not feel like it. And also, I think having a social life or having, you know, like a really active social life had to take a back seat as well, because a lot of my evenings were spent painting. A lot of my off time is spent painting. And that holds true for today too.
Yeah. we have to dedicate so much time and be so focused on it. And there's a cost to that a lot of times.
Mm-hmm. I was out of school for a couple of years. I was thinking about going to graduate school. I was applying to shows and I had landed my first solo show, which was great. I was very excited. And while I was preparing the work for that show, I had a year to prepare the work for the show. And while I was preparing the work for that show, I found out that I was pregnant with my first child. So that was unexpected. And, you know, I like to say I renegotiated the idea of being an artist twice. Once when I left school and was really trying to establish myself right out of school. And then again, as a young mother, after having two children and coming back to taking my art more public again. Yeah, while my children were young, my art practice became more of a private practice. It was a more personal practice. I kept a lot of sketchbooks. I scaled my work down so that it was more manageable. And I found, I know a lot of mothers, a lot of parents, I should say, who are artists and they make it work. And I love seeing that. And for me, what I found was that I had the bandwidth to make the work, but I didn't really have the bandwidth to also put the work out into the world and market it the way I would have liked to have been able to do. So some of that making it work in those interim years was being realistic about what I could do during those years and keeping that little seed of my intention alive so that when my kids got a little older, kind of mid-childhood, I think I took about 7 years where, you know, I really scaled my practice down. And it was at that point, about 7 years into being a parent, that I was ready to expand it again and approach scaling my work back up, scaling my practice back up, having it be a much more regular thing, and then also putting my work out into the world.
I love that. And I think it's something that so many artists deal with. It's an issue that I don't think people talk about enough, honestly. And the sort of ebb and flow of the career that happens naturally with life, with all the different life stages. And I know that from talking to other artists that during that time, either the choice to have kids or when they're young, when they're newborns, when they need all of your attention, there's the fear that you'll just stop painting and never paint again. Did you have that?
Oh, absolutely. I thought about it a lot during that period of time. And, you know, frankly, I also had the attitude that it was a test of my commitment and my determination to doing it. I think I've always understood that it's not an easy thing to do, making art. You know, let's face it, we get up every day and we have freedom to do what we want, but we also don't have anyone telling us what to do. It's, we decide the parameters, we call the shots, and we also observe the failures. You know, it's kind of all on us, right?
Yeah.
So I wasn't sure. I thought, okay, this, you know, having children, having these babies, this is what's in front of me right now. And the art was kind of on the back burner, but I also had in my mind that being a parent was going to test my determination, and that when I came out the other side, as I knew that I would after a few years, I decided that if it wasn't to be, it wasn't to be, and that rededicating myself to it would just be another test.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I love the way that you phrased it, that your art was going to become a private practice during that time. I think we are all very familiar with the fears surrounding being a parent and maintaining a painting practice. I'm sure we don't need to go over any of that for people listening. I would love to hear, though, what you have found the benefits to be, because I don't know if I'm reading into it, but I can already pick up on a couple that I was like, oh, yeah.
Oh, there have been enormous benefits. I am not the same artist. It was like one Lisa went in to parenthood and another Lisa started emerging out of being a parent. And some of the things that I was able to develop in myself during that. It wasn't a latent period of time because I was still making art, but it was a private time of being an artist, was that I became, and some of this emerged directly out of being a parent, is that I developed my patience, my attention for detail, my time management. Oh my gosh. Having children just lights a fire under you in that way. You know, I knew, and I know you've probably heard this from other artists who are parents who are also raising kids, that, you know, you get 3 hours in the studio or an hour in the studio and you just dive in like nobody's business, you know, because you know that your time is so limited. And so my ability to engage with the work became very compressed. That, you know, before I had kids, I would stand in front of my painting and then go make a cup of coffee. And I had all the time in the world. Yeah, some of it is procrastination and some of it is just a very leisurely way of engaging and kind of finding my way into the work every time I would go to the studio. Whereas, you know, once I had small children and was starting to have a regular practice again, I would be working within 10 minutes. I'd be in. I became very good at just immediately being able to engage and get some work done. So it was very good for my work ethic. And I think there was something in there too, which comes with time. I'm not sure if this is something that came from parenting, but I think some of it was just that at that point I was in, you know, I was around 30. Yeah, like early to mid 30s. I just was much more methodical too about how I approached my practice. And I think before I kind of threw myself at it, which wasn't a bad thing. I had a lot of good work come out of that period. But later on, when I was reapproaching, kind of renegotiating, building an art practice, I became more methodical about that. And now on this end, I do a lot of writing. I do a lot of different things to cultivate my practice in a very broad way.
I was wondering about that, because when you said that you kind of had 7 years more or less of this period where you considered it your private practice, I sort of just imagine that you must have discovered a lot about who you are as a painter. And maybe I'm wondering, did you become more resolute about your vision?
I think so. Yeah, I became more stubborn. I think it developed my commitment.
Yeah. It sounds like it would. And the sort of like, this is how I paint. I've had 7 years to work this out and think about it. I think if you told people like, okay, nobody's going to see your work, but that piece of it is going to be on the back burner and you're just going to have this time to paint, it's partly exciting and partly scary.
Mm-hmm. I think there's something to be said for making work that you decide from the get-go that you don't have to show to anybody. There's value in that. And I still do that. Right now, I'm working on a new body of work and I'll show little bits and pieces on Instagram here and there, but it's very much in flux. And one of the things I tell myself is I don't have to show this to anybody if I don't want to. That's very helpful.
It is. It's exciting.
Yeah. Yeah. And I feel more brave in that arena, which is more private. It's easier to take risk. It's easier to have an attitude that I really have nothing to lose in that arena. So oftentimes I'll develop work and not really make too many commitments to people. You know, like I wouldn't want to be in this stage of development when I have a solo show coming up. You know, when I've already made a commitment, or when somebody is expecting one thing and yet I'm delivering something else, that's too much pressure.
How do you develop a series from its infancy, from that stage where it's just this wandering thought in your head all the way through to, you know, maybe something that you are at first not showing to anybody, and then it becomes the thing that you're working on, and maybe it is something that you are going to show in a gallery or approach a gallery with?
I think the best things have just started with curiosity. So I'll use the project that I've been working on for a few years as an example. I was poking around online, and I walk every day, and I discovered that there's a trail called the Bay Trail, and it goes around the San Francisco Bay. the way it works is that each community is kind of responsible for developing its section of the trail. So one city might have, you know, some developed trail, another city might have partially developed trail, et cetera. And it goes all the way around the bay. It's about, they keep adding to it. So I think at this point, it's probably almost 400 miles.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really long. And most of it is right around the bay. Like you could see water, you can be in the marshland, and then parts of it go, you know, onto city streets. And so I got really curious about it. And I thought, wow, wouldn't that be so cool to walk the whole thing? And it was just this crazy idea. Then, you know, I didn't think that much about it for a while, and it kind of percolated for a year or so. And I'd go back and revisit the website and kind of look at the, you know, look at where the trail was. And then I thought, actually, what precipitated this was that my dad died. And, you know, in the year after he died, I was thinking a lot about him. And he was a very project-oriented person. And I had this, and it occurred to me that he would really have appreciated this idea of walking all the way around the bay. And so I decided to just try it out, to test drive it. And I drove out to the trail, and I had this idea that I was going to go and walk, and that I would sketch along the way and take notes. And I got out there and realized after a mile or two, you know, and kind of awkwardly stopped and did a little sketch, and it just didn't feel right. So I pulled out my camera and I started taking photographs. So I guess my point is that I had an idea, but, you know, the curiosity, the seed was there, but then it just, I was open to it taking its own form as well. So, you know, I had an idea, but I was open to it being something else too. I started taking photographs, and then I think the next day it occurred to me, oh, I should put those on Instagram. And eventually, in the next week, I went out and did another section of trail. And then a week after that, I did another section of trail. After test driving it for a few weeks, I thought, I want to do this. This is great. And I figured out that if I walked, you know, a certain number of miles each time over, you know, once a week over 2 years, I could do the whole thing. What it turned into, I think, because I was allowing the space for it to come into its own to some degree, was that I would go out every week at dawn, and I would walk between 3 and 9 miles of the trail and photograph. And then I would, over the course of the next week, I would start posting the photographs online. And what ended up happening was that I started, you know, having this body of work, just the photographs, this body of material that started filtering into my painting practice. And also I started having this little community online that were following me around the bay. And it's just been awesome. I'm still doing, I finished up the project. It took 2 years and I finished the project kind of officially, but then I took about a 6-month break and I thought, you know, I'm not done. I've been revisiting my favorite spots around the bay now. You know, going back to your question of how all of it comes together and how all of it develops, I think that imagery, I wasn't even sure at the outset what it was going to be. I didn't know if it would connect with my painting practice. Yeah, I wasn't sure how all those pieces were going to go together. Yeah, it wasn't orchestrated really. It was just a seed of curiosity. And then I followed that and then just kept allowing myself to be curious about where it wanted to go. And it's been a really rich source of material for me. I've been working on the material from this project for 3 years now.
And you're still curious and fascinated by it.
Yes. Yes. Every time I go out, it's different. I mean, one of the things that keeps it so interesting to me is that the area that I'm walking is, have you ever visited the San Francisco Bay?
Yes.
Have you been here? Yeah. It's interesting because parts of it are very industrial. Parts of it are very scenic. Parts of it are deep water. Parts of it are very shallow in the South Bay. You have a lot of salt evaporation ponds that are just crazy colors, pinks and reds and orange from the salt bacteria.
Oh, really? And that's yeah. In the South Bay. So would that be kind of in the general area of the San Francisco airport or?
That would be San Jose Airport. So Silicon Valley, well, it originated in the South Bay. Now kind of the whole Bay is considered Silicon Valley.
When you said 400 miles, my first thought was the same as yours. Like, oh my gosh, how fun to walk that. But also I'm kind of like, I'm just so curious now. Where does it start? And where does it end? If I can, I'm just trying to wrap my head around like how that works.
Well, it's a giant circle.
Okay.
So I started kind of in the middle of the Bay on the west side. And then I worked my way south all the way around the East Bay up into the North San Pablo Bay as well, which is part of San Francisco Bay. It's all a giant estuary. And then back down through San Francisco and then down the peninsula.
Okay, so I probably just forget how big that bay is.
Yeah.
And I'm imagining it winds a lot, so that's where you get so much of the distance.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, and some of the trails go up way up into the North Bay into like the Napa River and that area that I tried to just really do the trail that was close to the bay. What I'm more interested in is kind of transitional landscapes that are in flux in some way. So not only do you have like a tidal zone there, but you also have lots of areas that used to be industrial that are now being turned into wildlife preserves and replanted with all of the marsh plants to try to revitalize that. I think here in the Bay, we, you know, like so many other places that are along the ocean, we're realizing that we need that tidal zone to protect us from rising sea levels. So there's a big effort here to try to reestablish some of those plants and
reclaim the land for the...
Mm-hmm, exactly. Yeah.
I really love how you approach this with... You have the seed of the idea. This is something that I think is really important that artists either get stuck on or just don't know how to handle, which is when you're planning a big project like this, understanding that you're going to make a lot of plans, you're going to figure it out, you're going to do the best that you can to sort of like, okay, I have this idea and this is the direction that I want to go towards, but you're going to change it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we don't have a crystal ball. We're not going to say, okay, I'm going to do this to, you know, even, I don't know if you knew at the time if it was going to be a 2-year project, but I'm going to do this project and I know exactly how it's going to turn out. So I know it's going to be okay. So, okay, now I'm going to start.
Yeah, no, it wasn't pre-planned at all. And in fact, when I've tried to pre-plan projects like that, they've kind of fallen flat for me. I had an idea that I wanted to do a project about the Central Valley and all the farmland, because I actually grew up in the Salinas Valley. So for me, that theme of farmland is near and dear to my heart. So I thought I would go out there and photograph and kind of do the same thing. And it just didn't work as well.
Because you had planned it too much and weren't flexible, or?
Yeah, I'm not sure. Or maybe it was just a lemon. I'm not sure which. It just didn't take off quite the same way. I think part of it for me was that with the Bay Project, which I call the periphery project because I'm walking the periphery of the bay. With a periphery project, I'm walking. And I don't know if you have this experience, but certain things just tend to plug me into a flow state. And do you know what I mean by flow state?
I do, yes. I was actually going to say that, but I didn't want to go off on a tangent about that ability that you develop by having kids of just being able to jump right into your flow state. That is... I'm so envious of that, but continue.
Yeah. So walking does that for me. I think, you know, really repetitive activities do that for me. So walking is one of the things that really gets me in that place. Driving can do that for me sometimes, but I found that when I was trying to photograph in the Central Valley, I was in my car a lot. So I was driving rural highways and hopping in and out of my car and photographing. And some good material came of that. And I actually might pick that up again later. You know, I'm kind of waiting for it to tell me what it needs to level up to something that feels a little more juicy. But for the time being, I've kind of put it aside because it didn't really catch fire the way that I wanted it to.
I have so many questions I want to ask you. Okay. I love this. How do you respond to that when that happens, this idea that you thought that would be a really great painting project that's very near and dear to your heart. That is, I'm imagining it has some level of nostalgia for you, and that it would be something that on paper seems like it would be the perfect project for you. And yet it's just not there, you know? How do you respond to that?
Well, initially with disappointment. I think there is that little bit of letdown when I finally admit to myself that something just isn't working. I also try not to shut the door on things. I think, like with that project, I think it isn't really accurate for me to say, well, that didn't work and so I'm done with it. It would be more accurate to say, it didn't work the way I was trying to do it, or it didn't work then, but I feel like I just keep a door open, or I keep listening for some piece of that idea to click into place, which didn't happen right away. And, you know, that might still happen. So I'm just still open to that working out. I kind of have it in the back of my mind. You know, that's how I deal with a lot of those things, is I tell myself, okay, that didn't work in that way, but it might work later.
Mm-hmm.
And I just set it aside. And I also keep, I think I mentioned earlier, I do a lot of writing. So I have a tremendous amount of writing. So I have all this stuff written down. I have a lot of these ideas written down, and I just accept that 90% of it is not going to get used. I brain dump everything into journals. I keep a studio journal and I do morning pages.
I knew it.
Yeah.
Sorry, you can hear my paper rustling. That's my own journal. Yeah, I thought that was going to be the case. Like, as you were talking, like, oh, I had this really long conversation just recently about how important writing is to the act of painting. And for some people, that's the game changer, incorporating that other piece of ourselves into it.
Absolutely.
You know, you're realization, I guess, that the walking part of it has an impact in your work really resonated with me as well. It feels like, especially with the work that you do, you're so connected to the land and the landscape that you have to be in it.
Yes. If you look at my work, it's abstract. They're abstract landscapes, but there are references to things in the landscape. And I try to straddle the two. You know, I try to make abstract work that really references the actual landscape. So there are things in my paintings that I hope are evocative of the landscape. And I don't think I can get that personally. I can't get that any other way than actually going into the landscape. And not only going into the landscape, but going back over and over and over again. So for me, a lot of it is a process of absorption. So I'll go back to a site over and over again. Like, it's been really great going back to some of these places around the bay, revisiting them at different times of the year, and really seeing things differently, hearing different things, and just absorbing what that place feels like in a different way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about what happens next once you get back to your studio with all that reference material and the ideas that you've collected? Could you walk us through your process of creating your work?
Oh, sure. I work in a couple of different mediums. I think my approach to them, though, is very similar. I try to keep my approach very open. I guess from everything I've said, that's not a big surprise. But the way I begin work is very open-ended, and I tend to gravitate toward things that allow for a lot of surprise. So for about 15 years now, I've been working with encaustic, which is beeswax and pigments. It's very unpredictable. I mean, I've gotten from working with it so much, I've gotten so that I can control it pretty well. But the way that I work with it is I work with a lot of clear layers, and I embed layers of imagery in those layers. So a single painting might have between 15 and 25 layers. And then as those layers of wax build up, it diffuses the imagery a lot and adds a real sense of depth. So when I start building up the layers of the painting, I know that whatever those first layers are going to be set back visually, way in the background, but you can still see it all. It's just very diffuse. So it's kind of unpredictable. You know, I don't always know what it's going to be like. And it's kind of a call and response process. The most planning I do is maybe deciding a color, you know, what colors I'm going to focus on, usually pretty limited palette, and then maybe a thumbnail sketch, especially if I'm doing a commission or something, I'll do thumbnails. Yeah. So that's how I work with the wax. And the other medium that I've been focusing on for a few years now is acrylic washes, acrylic on paper, and I use it almost like a watercolor technique. And what I like about the acrylic instead of using actual watercolor is that I can build up these layers of washes without them affecting one another. So once it's dry, it's dry. So I like to work wet on wet. So I take the sheets of paper and I just soak them until they're like fabric. And then I can work with the inks and they do really interesting things, but it's really hard to control. So it's, again, very diffuse, very broad. And there's a lot of granulation and the ink moves around. And like the next morning, I'll come back to the studio and it's always wonderful to see what happened, because as it dries, it does all sorts of wonderful things.
Mm-hmm. It reminds me your process a little bit about, it just sounds like play and fun. You know, like I had this, when I was in college, I had this classes. There was two classes that were not intended to go together, but for me they did. And one was the properties of artistic materials. We're learning, you know, like what is this pigment made out of? And this one's heavier than that one. And this one, you know, like all that stuff. And there was another class where the instructor was just wanted everything to be an experiment. So it sort of felt like this. You ever have those books when you're a kid, or get those for your kids for, you know, just what happens when you put baking soda and vinegar together?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
So it's kind of like that in the studio.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you take those two classes at the same time?
I did. Yeah. So fun.
Yeah. What a great combination.
It wasn't on purpose, but it just worked out really well. But I remember doing all sorts of things with acrylics. And then I was curious about your salt series. Are you actually using salt in there?
No, I did try for a while. Yeah. But no, it's a series about salt.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, because we used to do the salt with, I think it was watercolor or gouache, was a fun little experiment because it makes the pigment do really weird things.
Mm-hmm.
So your encaustic and your acrylic work, so you go in and it's pretty open-ended. I have never, ever worked in encaustic, so I'm particularly curious about that. When you're layering the work, are you're layering with pigments, or is there any sort of collage work happening in there?
Mm-hmm. Both.
Okay.
The foundation of the painting is encaustic medium, which is beeswax and a smaller amount of damar resin that's melted into that. And I make my own medium so I can kind of control those ratios. And the damar adds a little bit of hardness to the wax, so it's not as easy to damage or scratch, and also some clarity to it. So that's kind of the main foundation of the painting. And from there, the way that I work with it, this is actually, I guess it's not that unusual. A lot of people use encaustic like a regular painting medium, you know, where they're layering more opaque and colorful layers and then fusing them together. But I work with a lot of clear wax. So I'll start with a layer of clear wax and then fuse that. So I use a torch. So every layer has to be heated into the prior layer. So it's kind of this lamination process almost. And I use cut paper. I do use colored, I use encaustic paint as well that has the pigment added into it. I've used, all sorts of materials. I mean, my works are pretty much, they would be described as encaustic mixed media. I use cut paper, I use powdered pigments, I use a lot of graphite. I use oil paint, glitter. It was a big thing for me for a while. Yeah. I really like materials that make the viewer question what it is they're looking at.
Mm-hmm.
Or like engage with it in a very physical way. And with the wax, that naturally happens, because one of the reactions I get when people see my work is it has this illusion of depth.
Mm-hmm.
So people will look at it And then they'll go over to the side and kind of look at it sideways to see how thick it is. And then I'll watch them. And then I'll watch them get back on it again and look at it because it looks like it's an inch thick, but it's a 16th of an inch thick or an eighth of an inch thick. So that's kind of funny. So what the glitter did was that as you would walk by the painting, it would change color, as you know, because it's reflecting light. So I like things that become kind of interactive like that.
I also, just from looking at your paintings, I just assume based on this conversation, and I'm sitting here staring at your website, I would assume about a half inch or an inch too. That's amazing. An eighth of an inch, you said?
Yeah. Yeah. They're very thin. Yeah. The layers are tissue paper thin. Some people work very thickly with this medium. It's possible to work just like really heavily textured, almost an impasto effect. But the way I work is very thin and very clear because I'm wanting the viewer to be able to see all the way back to the substrate. I'm wanting them to be able to see all the way back to the first marks I made.
Got it.
So if I work really thick, beeswax actually does become opaque pretty quickly, like within about a half an inch.
Okay.
Yeah, it gets very milky.
What I can't get over right now, I'm just like, I'm listening to you talk. I'm just trying to imagine this. And it's probably because I've never done encaustic that I'm stuck on this one part. But how do you even... I guess maybe I'm wondering, my answering my own question as I'm asking it, but how do you get like a really thin layer on there? You're putting paper and you're putting pigments in it. And then I'm sure you must control the heat, but from my perspective, I'm like, and then you take a blowtorch to it.
Yeah, it's pretty funny. And that's the secret sauce, really, to my work, is that I can have all of this very precise imagery in there and not blow it out with the blowtorch. So it's very delicate. Yeah, it's very delicate work.
Okay, this is probably because I've never done it. So I need to, obviously, I need to play with encaustic to be able to like not ask these questions. Like, wait, what? Everything that you're describing, I'm just imagining if you take a blowtorch to it, to me, my assumption would be that you would burn it or destroy it or it would change it. But your work, to me, even though you describe it as being open-ended and that you like surprises in it, it also, to me, looks very deliberate.
Yeah, I think I start a painting in a very open-ended way, and then about halfway through, I shift into a very deliberate mode where I'm adding imagery. I'm really responding to what happened accidentally, or not accidentally, but, you know, what I've already got down, which is a more general background. And then I start to put more precise layers on. And it creates a nice contrast between the more diffuse imagery in the background and then the more precise imagery on the surface of the painting that I think really makes it pop.
It does.
And enhances that illusion of depth as well.
It really does. Okay, I have to close your website because I'm going to get distracted by that. I always do this where, you know, like it's really helpful for me to have, like when I talk to people, I've got their Instagram accounts up, I have their websites up, I've got everything up so I can just like kind of pop back and forth. And as you're describing it, I'm looking at what you're talking about more or less. And then 10,000 questions come up. And on yours in particular, I'm just getting really caught up on the details.
Oh, they have a lot of details. They're very detailed paintings.
Yeah, they are. I'm still just completely fascinated by the precision that you have in your work and this vision that I have of you with a blowtorch.
I should make a video and post it on Instagram for you.
You should. I would love that. Will you?
Okay, I'll do that.
Okay. Can you talk more about your writing, how you use that in your work? I kind of want to ask you what you write about, but that feels really private.
Yeah, no, that's a really good question. I have learned more about the creative process from writers than I have from artists. I know that sounds a little crazy, but it makes sense if you think about, you know, that writers write. And so there have been so many good books published about the creative process by writers. You know, I'm thinking about one of my favorites is Bird by Bird by Anne Lamott.
I love that book.
Oh, I've read it 3 or 4 times and it never fails me.
Yeah. Bird by Bird. Sorry, just for people, because I know they're going to ask right away. Bird by Bird is Anne Lamott.
Mm-hmm.
Lamott or Lamott. Do I have it wrong?
Lamott, I think.
Lamott.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Lamott. And what they talk about is really using writing as an iterative process. You know, so many authors, so many writers talk about writing that way. And we get so many of our, the way we talk about the creative process, we talk about a first draft, we talk about a rough draft. It's easy to apply that iterative philosophy of creating to a studio practice for visual artists or for any artist for that matter, for dancers or anybody trying to engage with any kind of creative process. So that's the approach I take with my writing about art, about the creative process, is it just helps me get ideas down. It helps me notice patterns. If I find myself writing about something over and over again, you know, note to self, that's important. Go back and look at that. It's also a way for me to stash ideas. Like for my personal stuff, just for keeping a calendar and remembering that I had this interview today, like I keep a bullet journal. That's really helpful for me to stay on track of my personal stuff. And then for my studio practice, I keep a studio, like a giant studio bullet journal, basically, where I just stash everything. It's like brain dump. And then from there, I can go back and read, what was I thinking about last month? What was I thinking about last year? So it's very helpful for keeping track of those ideas, being able to go back and revisit them and pull up old ideas and see, where am I at with this now?
How long have you been doing this?
Well, the studio journal, probably about 5 years. And then the morning pages I've been doing on and off for 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 25 years. And actually, you know, I don't go back and read my morning pages very much because they are really, truly just brain dumps.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's just getting everything out to kind of clear the pipes.
Exactly.
Is how I see it. So that's not as helpful. But I think keeping a studio journal, and I really like the big dotted formats.
For the bullet journal. So what is the bullet journal? Is that a brand or?
It's a method of like a personal calendar, task lists, and note-taking all bundled into one book that you can have with you. So again, it's another way to have everything in one place. And the reason it's called a bullet journal is because you use a dotted list technique.
So you're just basically bullet pointing out your thoughts, yeah, in a way, not writing sort of extensively about it.
Right. And it's also iterative. So you carry your lists over to the next week. So I'll do that in my studio journal as well. I'll make a list of tasks for that week. You know, maybe I'm prepping paper for this group of paintings, and maybe over here I need to make a batch of medium. So I have studio tasks that I try to stay on top of. And if I don't get it done, I just carry it over into the next week. So that's it's a way to keep track of everything, but also keep everything very loose. You know, if I don't get something done, it's not the end of the world. I just carry it over into the next week. And it's also a place for me to jot down ideas while I'm working. So I always have it open in my studio. And I usually keep a running list of titles. Like if a phrase comes into my mind, or sometimes I'll keep song lists, or, you know, just cultivating these lists of things that are inspiring. It's a good place to keep all that in one.
Yeah.
It's messy, but it works.
I love it.
It's all in one place. Yeah.
My journaling is a mess and I don't go back and read them. And morning pages are that. What you said, it's a brain dump, or I just gets all the things in my head out of my head. And then it feels, you know, like you said, cleaning the pipes, but it is that. It feels like it's just, if you can get it down on paper, then you can release yourself from thinking about it, is how I kind of feel about it. So morning pages for me are just that word vomit, word.
Yeah.
I don't ever want to read those again.
Yeah. And I throw them out.
After, yeah.
You know, every 5 years or something, I just will toss a bunch of them because they're not really very productive in a forward thinking way. Like you said, they're just getting it all out, clearing the way for things that are more important.
Yeah. And, you know, it's really interesting. You're making me think that I use, you know, I've got my list and, you know, maybe it is a different form of that bullet journal that you're talking about. But, you know, of all the things that I have to do, what I consider to be my desk work, which tends to be stuff for the podcast or classes or whatever, I just write it down because if I don't write it down on a piece of paper, then I'm sitting there while I'm doing something else. I'm trying to keep track of, here's 10 things that you have to worry about. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of like, okay, you're going to go sit in this notebook until I actually do have to worry about you, but not right now.
Yes.
It's so helpful to just, the habit is if I'm focused on something and I'm one of those people, it's like I eat all of my vegetables at the same time and then I go on to the next food. And so I'm like that with my work too. you know, like I have to do this thing and I have to finish it. But as I'm doing that, I realize, oh my gosh, you have to remember to do this. And don't forget that, you know, do the sound check before you talk to Lisa, you know, things like that. If I write it down, then it sort of gives me permission to not think about it. And then I can like look at it later and cross it off and I can stay focused on the thing that I'm doing. And it sort of gives my mind permission to not worry about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I used to do that on a lot of little pieces of paper everywhere. Putting it all into one book has been a game changer because then I don't have to worry about it. I know that I've written it down in there.
Isn't that weird that it's like just knowing that you wrote it down makes you not worry about it anymore?
Yeah. And, you know, the way you described it was great that you think of something or you're doing one thing, but you have a thought about another thing. I tend to think of artist brains as being so associative that I can be working on one thing and just have this random thought about something else. And it seems so disassociated, but it's not, you know, like it is helpful to have those little offshoots, have a way of capturing that information. Like if I'm painting and I think of a painting title, to use that example, to have a place where I can just write that down and not lose it is great.
Yeah. Or sometimes you have that idea for the painting, that title, and you think that is such a great idea. I'm never going to forget that. And then 10 minutes later, you have no idea what it was.
Yeah. And of course, I always forget it. So I write everything down.
As I'm talking to you, I'm realizing that I'm really strategic and really diligent about doing that for my quote unquote desk work. And I do it in the studio, but not as much. So I think maybe I'm going to steal that and have a bullet open journal. I think keeping it open is probably the key. The writing is a thing that I've recently, like I would say in the last year, realized how much of an impact it has and how important it is. It was always more of a guilty pleasure, I think, than a tool for me. And now I'm realizing, no, that's essential.
It is. And I think it's essential to our creative process. I think that a lot of my ideas are developed through writing. And that when it comes time to write something like my statement or revise my statement or adjust my statement, which I do probably once every 6 months to a year, it's so helpful if I've been writing about what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
Because I kind of know what I'm about because I've been writing and following my own thought processes through writing. So I think writing is really valuable in the context of knowing what we're about, you know, knowing where my practice is going.
Yeah, it clarifies.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah. What other books have you found to be really useful for your art practice that aren't necessarily maybe thought of as art books? I'm thinking of Bird by Bird and other books like that.
There is one that it was actually published the year my daughter was born. It is a book for artists. It's written by David Bales and Ted Orland, I think. It's Art and Fear. It is a book for artists, but it's also almost a psychology book. It's really about, you know, how to approach the creative process. I found that incredibly helpful in those years when I was trying to figure out if I was going to keep making art.
Yeah, I can see that because it's definitely, I think that book does an amazing job of taking many of the thoughts that artists continually have and helping you to understand that you're not crazy. It's not just you and every other artist is out there thinking the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
So there's nothing wrong with you.
Mm-hmm. Another one that comes to mind, I have to warn your listeners, this one is a little bit crazy. It's Amanda Palmer, who is a musician. Do you know this book?
Is it Ask?
I think it's The Art of Asking. I listened to that a few years ago and it just blew me wide open. It was really a game changer.
Yes. I think.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think it helped me realize how important having a community is around my creativity, and also how to put myself out there a little more.
Yes.
Yeah.
There's a painting that I made basically while listening to the audio version of that book. And I can see, I can remember specific things she said in like a square inch of what I was working on or something like that, you know, like, oh yeah, that's where she was talking about, you know, that experience or the, you know, did you read it or listen to the audio version?
I listened to the audio version, and now I have a hard copy here at home that I dip into every once in a while, just when I need like a little taste of it.
Yeah, that is an outstanding book. I think that that book is another one that it helps you realize the power of the community and the sense of the support of it and the back and forth that comes from it. Especially now with social media, there is a tendency, I think of your audience or your community or whatever you want to call it as these people that you talk to rather than what Amanda brings to it, which is the people that you talk with.
That's a really good way to put it.
Love that book. I highly recommend it. It's a great one. The audiobook was great. She reads it, so it makes it much better, and she's really good at it.
Yeah, and it's interspersed with her songs. Yeah.
Any other books? I didn't mean to take over that and interrupt you.
No, those are what come to mind, really.
So I'm keeping you a little bit longer. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. I'm enjoying this conversation. It's great.
Good. Is there something that you wish you knew or that somebody had told you, let's just say 15 years ago?
You know, I wish I knew that all of my best work was going to come from what I didn't know, from not knowing, from being willing to go to a place where I didn't know everything. I think in those early years, I really felt the need to figure everything out ahead of time. And I've moved into a place now that I think is just so much more productive for me, where it's really just about taking a first action instead of knowing where I'm going. So with my current project, I didn't know where it was going, but I took that first step and just drove out to the bay and started walking without really knowing what I was doing. And I trusted that it would lead me somewhere. And 15 or 20 years ago, I wanted a plan, you know, and I wanted to know how everything was going to be. And so often it's just not like that. So if I could go back and talk to that younger Lisa, I think I would just say, just trust the process and it'll take you where you need to go.
Beautiful. Lisa, thank you. I think I need to hear that every day. Even though we know it, I think I need to hear it like on a recording.
I have to tell myself that every day. Still, it's what I needed to hear 20 years ago. It's what I need to hear every day today.
Lisa, thank you so much for talking with me today and spending time with me. I really, really enjoyed it.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you.
Well, I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Savvy Painter podcast with the artist Lisa Kairos. Go to savvypainter.com and click on the podcast link to see show notes for this episode. You'll find examples of Lisa's work, links to connect with her, as well as links to any artists or resources that we mentioned in our conversation. If you'd like to see Lisa's paintings in person, you can see them at Slate Contemporary in Oakland, California, Mixed Projects and Atelier in Telluride, Colorado, or Edna Contemporary in San Luis Obispo, California. So until the next time, this is Antrice Wood with the Savvy Painter podcast. Thank you so much for listening.